Gospel is very deep and very philosophical, although seems to be very simple. From one point of view, it starts with a so-called golden rule. Do to the others is the reciprocity. Do to the others what you want the others to do to you. This, you know, it is in the Old Testament and in almost every religion and even in every ethical system by different ways. For example, more positive ways, do to the others what you want the others to do to you, or by a negative way, don't do the others what you don't want them to do to you, or even by more, let's say, emotional ways. And many people say, oh, this is everything about, you know, about the justice and about the ethical behavior. But actually, it is not so simple, this thing. And many people misunderstand this. First of all, if because this is a general principle, right? Do to the others what you want them to do to you. It has nothing to do with God, right? I mean, even if you're Christian, even if you're not Christian, even if you're Buddhist, even if you're atheist, this makes sense from one point of view, from the beginning, right? If you see just generally. So what's the point of God? Where is God here? And why today, for example, the gospel says this, and we analyze, or we the Christians, and we close our eyes, and we don't see around us, because we don't live in a Christian country, of course, you know, that the others also say the same. And later I will explain to you that it's not exactly the same. And in Christianity, there is a unique way to do this. This is why Jesus Christ later, he starts, you know, with a common sense to the common people, and gradually it goes to a very deep way, which seems that it's not so simple to interpret this, oh, do to the others what you expect the others to do to you. For example, well, I want you to treat me well, so I must treat you well. I want you to, you know, to give me money, so I must give you money. It's not like that. First of all, even the philosophy can see different problems, philosophical problems, in this general and abstract principle. Because, you know, if I want the others to treat me, let's say, bad, you say, who will do this? Of course, there are psychological problems, and many people today, including me, of course, the modern people, you know, they have so many psychological disorders, problems, like you catch a cold. So if, for example, somebody has depression and he wants the others to scold him, so should I scold you? Kant, actually, you know, the great philosopher, it's not only Kant, but we don't do here philosophy lesson, criticized a lot about this principle. Because again, it says, oh, it's me who are asking something. And is this asking something a good way? You know, so I will say a few things more about this. Because actually, you see people who are just traditional Orthodox, and it happened to be born Orthodox, and they say, see, the gospel says, don't do to the others what you don't want you to do. I did not kill anyone. I did not steal the money or do any bad thing to others, so I'm okay. And the problem is that we are not okay at all, as I told you, because this is a general philosophical principle, which if you apply practically, not only does it work, but many times can create problems. What problems? Problems of isolation. For example, the Jews understood this thing inside the group. I mean, due to the brothers, right? To the brothers, to the other Jews, right? What you want them to do, your brother, because I want to help me, so I will help you. And so this is why, you know, when the commandment of God, when the Samaritan, when, you know, this young guy asked Jesus Christ, who is my neighbor, right? Who is my neighbor? Because he was expecting to hear, who is your neighbor? The other co-believer. The other who pretends or says that I'm Christian or I'm Jewish. And Jesus Christ said to him, who is the neighbor that should, you know, do the same thing? The Samaritan. He who has other religion, he is nationally enemy. And he was abused, he was almost dead, and he had the responsibility of this because he was going from the good place to the bad place. And this is the close man to me. And it comes to the question now, well, I expect from him to help me, right? So Jesus Christ, then this easy principle that we say and we isolate ourselves. Because today, you know, even in the churches, they say, look at this, I don't want too much with the church, far away. Just come, open my mouth, take the Holy Communion from time to time, and that's it. Far away from the bad priest or whatever. Right? I'm smart. I take what I take and I live. It's a bad place. Huh? So it's not like this. The person that I'm expecting, it is the enemy. It is the bad. It is the other religion or the atheist. And if you see the Chinese, you know, even although the Chinese, they say the same, the Kongzi say the same, and Buddhists say the same, but Chinese focus today, they have one Chinese, one problem, you know, one disciple asked Kongzi, should I answer to the bad with a bad way and the good way? I have forgotten, I will read you this, right? Yi ji bao yan, yi de bao de. You know this, right? So it was a question. And today this become a habit. Like, you behave to me bad, I will, you know, behave to you bad. And if you behave to me well, right, I will react with a good way to protect myself. And they dare to write this. And I tasted this. How hard taste is this? Yeah, it is a way of the Chinese torturing, because it was a mastery on torturing. And stretch the philosophy and the law. Jesus Christ says what? Explaining. What does he mean? Do to the others what you expect to do to you. He says, borrow, lend money to those who will not give you. And you say, well, what? I will lend money, right? I will give you money because I know you are going to give me back. But Jesus said, no. And he says, you know, when somebody slaps you, turn the other way. Huh? Who expects this to slap me to the other way? I will not, right? And Jesus Christ says something more strong than this, which is totally unbelievable. Somebody would say, unacceptable, what are you talking about? Love your enemies. Yeah. To love my enemy? My enemy wants to kill me. My enemy wants to abuse me, right? To destroy me. And when I say kill, don't think that killing is, at least in Taiwan, it's a democratic peace country, they're not going to kill you, like in some, you know, Muslim countries. But there are many other ways to kill your soul, to kill your love, to kill your career, and to kill everything by different ways, right? In the light. And Jesus Christ says, love your enemy. Eh? And what is this reciprocity? What is this, you know, golden rule? And what is this that we say, well, I did not kill anyone. What's the meaning of Jesus Christ when he used when he uses this general philosophical principle in every ethical system, and how does he change this? Once more I say, because I hear so many priests and so many sermons who say, wow, this is everything. And what they do, it's just a general ethical, interpretation, which is not a Christian interpretation. And allow me to say, most of them are nonsense, as it is explained. So Jesus Christ takes this and he uses totally a unique, and I say again, unique in the ethics and in religion point of view to understand this reciprocity. What reciprocity? You give a sword and I put my heart to enter inside. This is what God did. This is how God loved the world, right? That he gave his only begotten son. Gave means, you know, to sacrifice. He gave his only begotten son. So that, you know, just he loved and he gave. He did not say, well, you love me, what can I do? Of course, I will behave to you, right? The more you love me, the more I will give you. But God says the opposite, right? Totally opposite. And it is a very important thing to understand here. And you will say to me, then, Father, what are you talking today about, right? Who can do these things and how we could understand and re-understand and read better the gospel? Is this for everyone? But Jesus Christ said, you know, become perfect as your Father is perfect. He did not say, never mind, you come to the church, you know, every Easter just to have a candle, and if the church has not candle, you don't realize that this is an Orthodox church, do a big cross and, you know, all these things. It's okay. In case that there is God, you have some, you know, something, right? In case it's not, anyhow, it's useless, you don't believe. So this is about the perfection. And what perfection? And why is it so stupid, God, to say, to love my enemy, he wants to kill me? You know, from one point of view, yes, it seems to be stupid. From the other point of view, it is that, well, yes, take me if you want. But I know that there is somebody else who is loving me and loving you. It is our Father who art in heavens, right? Not my Father, it's also the Father of my enemy. He is God the Father, right? And he will take care of my life. And not only this, yes, I have the logic and the ability and the, of course, obligation to protect my life, not for me, so that I will not make you a murderer, for example, by catching you, by, you know, doing some things, right? Not to kill you, if possible. But I will not hate you. This is very, very important. Many people misunderstand also, for example, the Orthodox Church. Of course, if there is a war, there is priest. And if two Orthodox countries, they fight, there is priest here and priest here. But the priest does not pray for the winner, but he sees the soldier who is dying, no matter what he is, who needs to confess, to receive for the last time the Holy Communion. This is why. It's very needed, and it's very human, and it is love, even to participate and to understand that in front of the death, even in front of the bad duty, there is no enemy, just people who suffer the suffering that all the human beings we are in this life. It is so, we must think again and again and again. What is going to give to the other what we expect? And what we have to give to the other? The only thing we have is really Jesus Christ. We don't have other thing. This is why we come to the church, to take God. Not to take the gospel in some, you know, chips in my, in our minds, and to say, take a gospel, or to threaten some people, as some people threaten here, say, you see, the gospel says, you don't believe to Jesus Christ, you will go to the hell, which is, of course, ridiculous and ethical blackmail. But this is what we have to give, and this is what we have to take, and this is why we care, and this is why we love, and this is why we pray, and this is why this is ethics. The ethics in Christianity is not some abstract thing. Ethics is this, the body of Jesus Christ, that's it. The church, the unity of the church. Orthodox is not who says, I have membership. You know, everywhere you go to Taipei, to Taiwan, they want a membership card, you know, which is actually in the European Union, it's illegal because it's personal things. According to the law, even a supermarket cannot have you know, a catalog. But anyhow, everybody wants you to be a member here. But, you know, in the Orthodox Church, there is no membership. The membership is to receive the body of Jesus Christ. And this is what you are expecting to give to the others. And this is what we have to accept and to expect from the others. So I don't want to say today to say a lot of things about this, but to rethink again what kind of Christians we are and how do we understand the Christian practical life. As a general philosophical principle, which has so many logical mistakes inside, or as Jesus Christ explains this by a total new way. And you see, you know, many times the expectation from God, right, it's so opposite. What Job was expecting God to do, I mean, for him, at least, not to take 10 children, right? To take all his property, to take his health, right? Yes, he allowed the devil, but God has the ethical responsibility. So many times, you know, we expect from God the best, and we take the worst. Not really, but it is, right? And Jesus Christ in Golgotha was expected what? Take the cup out of me. And he did not do. He did not take. And still, this is the ultimate love. The ultimate love, which is, you know, to give ourselves totally to God and to the people. This means the church. And then everything will go. So now, you will see, this is the mystery of the liturgy. This is what we are doing in here. This is why we are coming here. Not just to do crosses and other things. And this is why I insist, I advise you to see, if possible, stay there. Don't stay like hiding, or if we had another room, to hide in another room. Just to listen and come, open your mouth and leave. Okay?